When the Israelites were taken captive, living in exile, many of their homes and the temple where they worshipped had been destroyed. A few years later, after they were allowed to return to the Promised Land, Israelites laid the foundation for a new temple. But the local people started interfering with the rebuilding process, and the Israelites became frustrated and discouraged. Eventually, the work of rebuilding the temple came to a halt. For the next 20 years, the temple sat unfinished as the Israelites focused on rebuilding their houses and farms. Then, God spoke directly to the leaders of Israel through a prophet named Haggai about the temple. Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains a ruin? Give careful thought to your ways, God told them. You have planted much, but harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but are not worn. You earn wages, only to put them in a purse with holes in it. God told the Israelites to go up into the mountains and bring back timber to rebuild the temple so that God would be honored. God explained to the Israelites that because they had built their homes before rebuilding the temple, God had prevented their crops from growing. The leaders of Israel listened to God's voice and the prophet Haggai and decided to obey God's commands. God spoke again through Haggai, telling the leaders, "I am with you." Finally, all of the Israelites currently living in Jerusalem began work on building a new temple for God to be worshipped.
They will feed you a delicious lunch, the same lunch that they provide for the homeless. You will get to partake in the breaking of bread and the peanut butter jelly sandwiches. And then you travel together to do their ministry. And sometimes it's prayer ministry, sometimes it's handing out food, sometimes it's coat, blankets. They do things to reach out to the homeless here in our community. Also, there is a small group lunch. You can talk to Corey for more details on that, or Steady, or Christy, or I guess James, too. You can call James and see what happens. But that small group lunch, it's here at the church on the 11th, and it's 6 o'clock, right? There's that. Weekly Bible studies are starting back up this week, so if you were happy to have your retreat or you miss it, either way, it's starting back up this week. So that includes women's ministries and men's ministries and all the Sunday school classes and so forth. Prayer requests. There's a number this morning, apparently a lot has happened with the new year. One being the Yorkham family, Denise died New Year's morning. Service is on Thursday. Remember also the Green and Eklund families, Shauna's father died. Those services are Saturday. And if you need more details on these, I'm sorry that I don't have them for you. You can call the church office at 297-4149. I'm sure you guys have memorized that. Call the church office, you can get more details. And no, it's 7362, isn't it? Yeah, I just gave you the fax number. I've been here a while. Wow. Do you know, just a site, I don't know why I'm telling you this, but my children had never heard the had the pleasure of the dialogue. Do you guys remember that? It was on TV the other day, and they're like, "What is that?" I'm like, "Oh, you do not know what it is." Remember also the Gamenti family, there's a death of a close friend in the last few weeks as well. Services here at the New Hope on Friday. Marna Fair had a heart attack. And
Chris, do you have any more information on that, you know?
She's not at the hospital, but that's the
hospital. Okay, stable. Okay. Very good. Okay, so those are some of the prayer requests. I'd like to direct your attention to, first we'll do these. I'm sorry, I'm not as adept at this as Pastor Tim is. He's been doing it for like 90 years, I think. This is like my ninth time. So never Tim's off in the cabin with his wife. They're celebrating their anniversary, so they're not here with good cause. I'll send these around. There's two announcements on here. The Women's Tuesday Night Bible Study, if you'd like to sign up for that. And a number of yellow pages due to the Corey's optimism that each of you will get involved in a small group. I would say more about that, but you'll hear it. And then these little cards. You might not be, hey, welcome. Yeah. Is that 5 minutes ago?
Sorry.
If you're new here,
we have history.
Yeah. We spent some time in youth ministry together, and they're pretty much family, as you all know. But just know if you're visiting, I would normally point you out like that. I apologize if I scared you here today. There's peace cards here. Anybody know what this little box up here is called?
QRC.
Yeah, it's a QR code. Raise your hand if you know what that does. Like 7 of you, cool. You can scan that if you like with your mobile device, and it will take you to a website. And that's something that was started new last year, so not a lot of people know QR code for something in the pews, and Tim never talks about it because, again, he's ancient. And so I thought I'd mention it. If you'd like to use that as a quick way to get to the online giving, you need to do that. Another way to give is the old school way. You can put money in these envelopes here, and you may not know, but you can put names on here, so if you'd like to make a contribution to the youth pastor's tuition reimbursement fund, you can certainly do that. Truthfully, this will be your very first opportunity to give a tax-deductible contribution for 2015, huh? He talks about that. So he's scared. Okay. Visitors, this is what I'm really trying to get to. This is called a visitor card on the pink side. If you are a visitor and you'd like to fill this out, put it in the offering basket. New Hope promises that we will not bother you on the phone, we will not be on your door, but through the mail, we will send you an information regarding New Hope Community Church. Once you receive that information, however, you're certainly welcome to call us back at the church, email us, put another note in the offering basket. And if you would like us to bother you on the phone, if you would like to do that, or don't meet on your door, we'll do that. Say, Lord, just simply take you out for a cup of coffee or tea or whatever your Christian crack fix is. We'll do that for you. And mostly we're just trying to get to know people and make sure that if you're a visitor, you feel welcome. So we want to get you plugged into things like small groups, and that's our hidden agenda. So there you go. Communication requests on the backside, that's green portion. So if you have a prayer request, would like to communicate something to the church, or if you want to do advice, you know, now you can go ahead and fill that out and put it in the offering basket as well. Is that all clear as mud? I feel like I talked kind of fast, but maybe I'm nervous. With that, I'd like to invite our ushers to come forward as we prepare to receive our morning. Would you pray with me? Father God, I'm reminded as I stand here that this is the first Sunday of the new year. We've been together. And as I gaze on familiar faces, I'm reminded also, God, that we're here because you've created within us a family. Like families, God, we don't always get along, we don't always agree, but you've unified us with something more important than our own agendas, and that's your agenda. You told us that begins with love, that we're to love you first and extend that to the people around us. For that we say thanks to Christ Jesus. Without it, we have no sense of meaning in this life, no purpose. Indeed, vanity, everything is vanity under the sun, but with you, Jesus, we have reason. We have reason to get up. So thank you. Thank you that you challenge us within our family to offer our services to one another. To be available to meet others' needs. I understand that you call us to do that through management of our time, God, management of our money. So as we do that this morning, I pray that we would give with glad and sincere hearts, God, and that you would receive it as a pleasing aroma. We love you, Jesus. We say amen. Amen.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year.
Good morning.
So when Tim asked if I would talk, I said, sure. And then I thought, it's been a whole year since he asked me before. I don't know how to read into that for a whole year. But I don't really like to focus on like all the negatives, so I thought, a whole year, like, maybe that makes it like an annual thing. It's very special, right? Like a holiday. One of those very secret holidays that he doesn't tell you about because he's afraid you won't celebrate it. So then, after I said okay, then I was trying to figure out where in the Believe chapters we would be. And I first counted and I thought we were going to land on giving resources. And then I knew exactly where Tim had left me that way. But then I did the math and I was like, oh, okay, we're good. It's offering my time. And I was excited about that. And then as I started to think about it and pray and believe, I realized that maybe offering my time might almost be a little bit more touchy and personal than even talking about finances. And that thought occurred to me as I was thinking about the story. Remember, the last chapter that we talked about was the spiritual gifts chapter in the series. And he told that story about the truck and the chickens. Do you remember this? And we were talking about how do you identify your spiritual gifts. And he said, think about, you know, where would you fall in this? Would you help lead people to help solving this solution? Would you gather chickens? Would you be ministering to the people involved? You know, how would you be involved in this incident? And I had this thought that challenged me a little bit, that perhaps there's another part to this. Is there a chance that I would have just driven by and not even stopped to be part of this? And I had that thought because it's probably true. There's probably been a few things I have just driven by. Either because I thought it was going to be more important or more pressing or I was late, right? Or I just was not paying attention. I was doing something else, thinking about something else, kind of caught up in my own thing, maybe on Facebook or texting, not while I was driving, of course. But missed it completely. Just missed that there's this thing going on over here that I could be part of, to share my gift, and instead just drive on by. And I don't think I want that to happen anymore. And so that's what these verses are about, is how God has given us time. And we can spend it in regret of the things we've driven by, or we can realize He's given us today. Today we're here. We're awake. We're here. We've been given this day. And we've been given this day for a reason, to fulfill God's purposes in us. So there is a, I have no idea where I am on camera. There is a key verse in the for this chapter 18, offering my time, and that's Colossians 3, verse 17. And Colossians 3, verse 17 says, whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. I like to look at verses, but I like to also look at a chunk of verses to see where is this coming from? What's the context? And if we want context on how God wants us to use our time, we are going to find it starting in verse 12 of Colossians 3. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one. Forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you are called to peace. And be thankful. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through Him. So we see that this isn't just whatever you do, do it in Jesus' name. Whatever you're doing, you know, put Jesus' stamp on it. There's some very specific things leading up to this, whatever you do. When you're loving, when you're forgiving, when you're living in unity, when you're small grouping. Sorry, we didn't have to do that, right? Small grouping. Because this very small grouping, right? Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, as you sing psalms and hymns. Bond together in perfect unity. So it's pretty small. But it's also when you're at work, right? But it's about Him. People see Jesus because you're loving and you're forgiving. It's when you're on a play date with another mom and you guys are sitting there, that the time is dedicated to Him. That before you go to lunch with that friend, you offer the time to Him. Go to lunch with this friend, the time is yours, do what you will. So in whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus. There's this story that was kind of in the notes that went along with this chapter, and I heard this story before, and I didn't like it the first time, but I figured I should share it with you so you can help me a little. So, a man had been working very long hours for quite some time. One evening, he came home late again, exhausted, to find his five-year-old son waiting after him. I prefer to make this about a man and his son, so it's about you guys, not about me. Daddy, can I ask you a question? Sure, I guess. What is it? Replied the dad. How much money do you make in an hour? Tired and irritated, he snapped, what makes you ask such a thing? The son answered, I just need to know. Please tell me, how much do you make in an hour? Well, I make $20 an hour. Looking up for his father, the boy asked, Daddy, may I borrow $10, please? Father was now furious. If the only reason you wanted to know how much money I make is just so you can buy a toy or some other nonsense, then you march yourself straight to your room and go to bed. I work long, hard hours every day, and I don't have time for this right now. The little boy quietly went to his room and shut the door. After a bit, the dad calmed down and began to think he may have been too hard on his son. Maybe he really did need the $10 for some good reason. He went to the door of his little boy's room and said, are you asleep, son? No, I'm awake, Daddy. I've been thinking maybe I was too hard on you earlier, said the man. It's been a long day and I took out my frustration on you. Here's $10. What do you need it for? The little boy sat straight up. Oh, thank you, Daddy. Reaching under his pillow, he pulled out some crumpled bills he had saved from his allowance. Why did you want more money if you already had some, the father asked, about to get irritated again. The son slowly counted out his money and then looking up at his dad said, because I didn't have enough, but now I do. Daddy, I have $20 now. Can I buy an hour of your time? Right? And I am a mother of 5 and 6 year olds and for long hours, so clearly I have feelings about the story, so I'm not sure who you did. But it does put perspective, right? It in two ways. One, it forces us to think about priorities. Where are we spending our time? How are we using it? But then it also, I think possibly more importantly, helps us realize that we have a Father in heaven who doesn't work for $20 an hour. We don't have to come up with money or things. We don't have to beg our God to spend time with us. He's there. He wants to spend time with us. And are we acknowledging that? Are we giving the time back to Him? And all He does in all these verses that I've read is honor that time. We don't have anything to lose. So Psalm 90, verse 12 says, so teach us to number our days, that we may present to you a heart of wisdom. Teach us that time matters, because it does. David in Psalm 39, 4, verse 4 through 7 says, show me, Lord, my life's end and the number of my days. Let me know how fleeting my life is. You have made my days in your hand, breath. The span of my years is as nothing before you. Everyone is but a breath, even those who seem secure. Surely, everyone goes around like a mere phantom, and vain they rush about, heaping up wealth without knowing whose it will finally be. But now, Lord, what do I look for? My hope is in you. And maybe that's all we can say, is I don't know what I'm supposed to be doing. What am I supposed to look for, God? My hope is in you. And that's what he wants from us. Because time is a resource given to us by God. And how we use that time reflects our esteem for him. And we will give an account for that time. So there's a study that was done that showed how 18 through 64-year-olds used their time. And in their minutes of each day. And included were sleeping, working, watching TV, housework, travel, eating, socializing, recreation, and the entire 3 minutes. Childcare, dressing, washing, reading, relaxing, etc. Significantly, perhaps, worship and devotional activities did not appear in studies. God has given us this day. He has given us this time. Matthew 25, starting verse 34. It says, then the king will say to those on his right, come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came and visited me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in and eating clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? And the king replied, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. When we give our time back to him, he can put it all in order. So we have to sleep, we have to eat, we have to get dressed, we have to do all those things. But when we give the time to him and allow him to manage our time and maximize our time and multiply our time, which I believe when we give it to him, he can do, just like he can do with loaves of bread and fish, he can maximize and multiply our time so that it fits what he wants, fits time with him, serving others, loving others, worshiping him. So how do I best use my time to serve God and others? That's our key question. How do I best use my time to serve God and others? And it starts with that priority of recognizing that Jesus in us wants to love others and that we can find joy in that. So we can find joy in spending our day off helping a widow down the street with repairs on her house, which small groups have been doing for each other. That we would find joy in assisting a single mom by watching her kids while she goes to the grocery store or while she gets some relaxation. Why you would maybe want to mentor an at-risk student once a week, which if you're interested, we are doing that at my middle school. Why you would want to volunteer in the church nursery or maybe add another commitment like a small group. Because it seems to add, right? It feels like it's adding something on top of what you're already doing. And that's where I think we have to shift that thinking back to, I'm giving my time to God, and he will organize what all that is. Because the key idea is that I offer my time to fulfill God's purposes. Because I don't know if you've noticed, but this is not heaven. If you watch the news, or you talk to a friend, you're reminded over and over again that this is nothing. We have eternity of perfection. Eternity that is beautiful beyond what we could even imagine here. Eternity without tears or bad news. Bad news on TV. We have eternity for that. And yet so often we try to make this place as comfortable and beautiful and as heavenly as we can make it, but this is not heaven. We have a place that is prepared for us there. But we're here for a different purpose. We're here because we're running this race to show God's compassion, to love others. We don't get to be spectators yet in this race. We're running. Jesus hung on the cross and made his sacrifice all about us so that we could lay aside that self-focused, chasing after the wind life and give our lives back to him so he could fill it. He's our motivator and wants us to devote our schedule to him. Galatians 2:20 says, I have been crucified with Christ and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. That's our purpose. I mention small groups because, I do that often. And part of what I was thinking about, what does small groups have to do with time and offering my time? And I think it has a lot to do with it, because I think one of the big reasons why people don't do small groups is because it takes time and finding the time. When do I do this? And then I have to watch a video before I go. That's another chunk of time, right? And then I'm hearing what these groups are like going and doing service activities. So that's another chunk of time. So it definitely has something to do with time. But I can tell you this. I am grateful for my small group. It is something that probably is not as spiritual as some of the other small groups. There's also stories of very spiritual things that other small groups have done. Mine, and I was reminded of this as I was looking through photographs throughout the year because I was trying to put together an annual calendar for my family. I came across these pictures of when my small group came over and built my kids' play structure. And this was a small task. It was lots of boxes with little pieces and lots of parts. I just went inside and tried to find snacks for people because I wasn't about to try to tackle the directions. They had to like watch DVDs and things. But I loved looking at these pictures and I thought, why is this important? But I looked at these pictures and there are my kids riding around in the midst of 13, 14 grown-ups who had given up their day, given up their time for them. And we were laughing and having fun and fellowship and enjoying each other's company while doing that. And I thought, how often do kids see that kind of interaction with grown-ups? That they're watching TV or movies, that's not usually what grown-ups are doing to have fun with each other, right? But they got to see that grown-ups had fun doing this for them. And then I realized it actually was kind of spiritual, because I don't know if you came to the Heaven is Real children's play. The kids were all dressed like angels and sang about heaven and all that. My kids were in it. And we took up like three or four rows over here because the entire neighborhood came to watch my children, these little angels. And I found out later part of the reason why. Well, actually most of the reason why, because I kept saying, thank you for coming. I mean, they're so excited you're here. And they said, how could we not come? I said, well, no. Oh, you couldn't come. Oh, come on. They've been standing on top of this play structure singing to us for the last, I don't know how long, and telling us, you'll see more when you come to our show. I mean, people on the street behind my street, I now discovered this, we've completely ruined privacy in our neighborhood, but we have very gracious neighbors. And they have been singing Heaven is Real, and I can only imagine, from the rooftop of their play structure and inviting them to come watch this play. And I did. I had three or four rows. And so thank you, small group, for building the imposition. So we weren't feeding homeless people, which we probably should do. But they saw a grown-up sacrificing their time for them. That's love, right? That's love. I've also realized with small groups and helping form your groups that I'm so glad you're there. Because there's so many times where I have people that I'm getting to know, they want to be in a small group, and I already know you. And I know your stories, and I know the journeys that you've been on. And I know exactly where people need to be, because you're there. And so it's this realization that sometimes we join something not because of what we're going to get from it. I'm going to join the study because it's a study I'm interested in. I'm going to join ReShare because I'm going through this, or I'm going to join the women's group for the men's Saturday. You know, I'm going to do this because of what I'm going to get from it. But maybe if you feel that calling to join, it could be because what God can do through you or somebody else in that space. Does that make sense? So what difference does this offering your time to fulfill God's purposes have in the way you live? And I think the difference it has in the way you live is tied back to, remember, the chapters kind of connect with each other. This chapter, offering my time, is connected to chapter 8's compassion, which makes sense, right? Why would we pour out our time for somebody else if we don't care about them? But when we care about people, when we love them, we want to give them our time. And so this is tied back to compassion. And you can kind of think of it as this. You can be assigned to a service, right? To go feed the homeless or build a play structure or whatever. You can be assigned to a service. And that's completely different than the stirring of your spirit to give because you love. And God's not assigning you community service. We're putting ourselves before Him and saying, do what you will. I'm here today. The time is yours. Romans 12 says, be transformed by the renewing of your minds. In view of God's mercy, we are to offer our bodies as living sacrifices. This is our spiritual act of worship. It's our worship to say, do what you will. He loves us and He loves others through us. There's a book that I have read and reread and given to people because it challenged me. And it's called The Return of the Prodigal Son. And it's about the author really, really dissects the parable of the lost son in light of Rembrandt's painting and just really analyzes it. And the parable of the lost son, right, is the son takes his inheritance early, runs off, squanders it, and then realizes he has nothing, he has nobody, so he comes back to the father's house just to ask to be a servant in his home. And instead he's welcomed with open arms, a party's thrown, the father announces, you know, my son was lost and he's come back. And then there's the other brother, right, who had been home all along, and he sees all this and he's kind of jealous and a little bitter because of all the attention the lost son has received. And the father says, you've had all that I have all this time, so, you know, get over it, kind of thing. So, here's my engagement, checking for understanding strategy here. I want you to think about who do you relate to when you hear the parable of the lost son. And if you're going to show me, I'm going to count it through your fingers. One, the lost son, the prodigal son. Two, that elder son that stayed home. Three, both. Maybe you have felt like both. Or this is your safe place, right? I just don't want to tell you or don't know right now. Okay? Ready? One, the prodigal son. Two, the elder brother who stayed home. Three, both. Not going to tell you right now. Don't know. Ready? One, two, three, go. I didn't say a third of you could just not. Maybe this is an option. So here's why this challenge. I'm amazed at how long it has taken me to make the father the center of my attention. It was so easy to identify with the two sons. Their outward and inner waywardness is so understandable and so profoundly human that identification happens almost spontaneously as soon as the connections are pointed out. For a long time, I had identified myself so fully with the younger son that it did not even occur to me that I might be more like the elder. But as soon as the son said, aren't you the elder son in the story? It was hard to see anything else. But what of the father? Why pay so much attention to the sons when it's the father who is the center? And when it is the father with whom I am to identify? Why talk so much about being like the sons when the real question is, are you interested in being like the father? It feels somehow good to be able to say, these sons are like me. It gives a sense of being understood. But how does it feel to say, the Father is like me? Do I want to be like the Father? Do I want to be not just the one who is being forgiven, but also the one who forgives? Not just the one who is being welcomed home, but also the one who welcomes home. Not just the one who receives compassion, but the one who offers it as well. He goes on to explain that compassion can be shown in three ways, through grief. And he describes grief as that willing to see what has just happened on the side of the road, being willing to see it, pray about it, mourn for the loss, forgiveness, and generosity. Grief allows me to see beyond my wall and realize the immense suffering that results from human lostness. It opens my heart to a genuine solidarity with my fellow humans. Forgiveness is the way to step over the wall and welcome others into my heart without expecting anything in return. Only when I remember that I am the beloved child can I welcome those who want to return with the same compassion as that with which the Father welcomes me. The third way to become like the Father is generosity. In the parable, the Father not only gives his departed son everything he asks, but also showers him with gifts on his return. And to his elder son, he says, all I have is yours. There's nothing the Father keeps for himself. He pours himself out for his sons. Time is of the essence. If you're a prodigal son chasing after the winds, run to the Father now and accept his forgiveness and his mercy and claim your seat as son or daughter and be restored. That's why Jesus died for you, to redeem you. There's no time for you to If you're the older son, surrender your jealousy, your bitterness, or your daydreams or fantasies of what you might be missing, and embrace your seat as son or daughter, and celebrate the name of his saint. It's Coronation Day. Celebrate the good news. Surrender your life to the giver of all compassion and mercy and allow him to live and love through you as the Father does, to embrace the unlovable and the unworthy. We are only here in this place that is not heaven for a blink of an eye. So, while offering our time to fulfill God's purpose is a straightforward concept, there's maybe some suggestions to help plan or prioritize. I think first is the prayer, it's that surrender piece of, God, this is all yours. I don't know what you're going to do with it, but it's all yours. Help me see. Teach me. And then there's some of the practical piece of just evaluating, looking at your time. How am I spending my time? And then asking yourself the honest questions. Does my schedule reflect how God wants me to use my time? What adjustments should I make? Where am I allowing room for temptation or sin? Is there an activity I believe God is calling me to stop or delay? Is there an activity that I believe God is calling me to add to my schedule? Where can I make room for the use of my spiritual gift? And be honest with myself. Because time is wasted in disobedience. We see that with Jonah, right? God tells Jonah, go to Nineveh. And Jonah says, I'm going to go out of my way. I'm going to Nineveh. I'm going to go to Nineveh. No. And instead, he gets a ticket to a ride to Tarshish, right? And just like what I think many of us do when we're not doing what we're supposed to be doing, he goes and sleeps, right? He hides and sleeps. And the storm is brewing, and the sailors are freaking out. What is happening? Somebody has done something to upset God, and he's sleeping. And then finally, he wakes up, and he says, it's me. I'm being disobedient to God. Throw me overboard. But couldn't he have said, take me to Nineveh? Instead, he says, throw me overboard. But he says, throw me overboard, and the storm will stop. And they don't really want to, because they feel like that's not very nice, but they finally do. They throw him overboard, and he is swallowed by a giant fish, right? And how long is he there?
3 days.
3 days. And then he's right? He's vomited a bunch of dry land, and he decides, perhaps I should go to Nineveh. So he goes to Nineveh, and Jonah 3 says it was an important city, a visit that required 3 days. God cares about time. So this could have been an offering of 3 days of time in Nineveh, right? But instead, it was a 3-day stay in a giant fish and 3 days in Nineveh. God cares about time. And disobedience wastes time. Look for the small moments that maybe you can change how you're spending your time. Maybe if you're hands-free in your car, you can call people and check on them. Or you could pray for the people you just left from. You probably heard some stories of brokenheartedness. You could pray for them, your eyes open while you're driving. Perhaps you could seek out a ministry opportunity during your lunch or some other chunk of time. And don't be afraid that God may do something different than what you thought. Right? Because I'm pretty sure most of the faith-building stories in here are about how God used it in a different way than they expected. You're alive. You're here. God has a purpose for you. I don't know what that is, but I think if you seek Him, you'll figure it out. We started a mentoring thing at my school. Middle school. Talking to grown-ups, right? We weren't sure how this was going to go, how the kids would respond, what grown-ups would show up, but they did. Some grown-ups have shown up. Grown-ups on all different spectrums. We have college kids. We have kids that are totally out of dress code that we love them anyway. And then there are many retired people. And we matched them up. And there's a man who comes who was in a car accident many years ago where he was ejected from his car. And he is paralyzed on one side and has other issues from this accident. So he uses a walker, and sometimes it's hard to understand him, and he paid me. And we matched him. And we thought, And he spent some time with the kid that we matched with, and that kid said to him, I don't know if you have the time, but do you think maybe you could come twice a week? And I can't imagine that this man ever thought that a 12 or 13-year-old would want to see him 2 times a week. But he does, and God's honoring that time. So be open to what God has for you. Because sometimes it's exactly not what you expect. Again, pray. Prayer is the first step of asking God to guide you and how you manage and use your time so that He can maximize it, so that He can multiply it, so that He can bless it. We saw in the video up here, the Haggai, right? And I wish I could memorize this and because I love the attitude that's in this. It's a little... But the people were to rebuild the temple, right? And he says, this is what the Lord Almighty says. These people say, the time has not yet come for the Lord's house to be built. These people are trying to tell God what time it is. It's not exactly what's written here, but this is how I read it, right? These people are not going to tell me what time it is. And God goes on to tell them what time it is, right? So he says, then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Is it a time for you yourselves to be living in your paneled houses while this house remains ruined? Now this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. You have planted much, but you have harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but you are not warm. You earn wages only to put them in a purse with holes in it. You are not satisfied because all that you have is not mine. You have not given it to me. You have not surrendered yourself to me, so you are not satisfied. You have not been blessed by all that I have to offer, because you are holding. That's not exactly what it says in here, but it is. So this is what the Lord Almighty says. Give careful thought to your ways. Go up into the mountains and bring down timber and build a house and sell them. This is between you. This is what time is, people. This is what you're going to do. And then this is what I love. This is what I love about our God. Verse 13. Then Haggai, the Lord's messenger, gave this message of the Lord to the people. I am with you, declares the Lord. I am with you. I'm not sending you off to do something that you don't want to do all on your own. I am with you. Even though we just talked about how they had just not been doing what God had said, he didn't abandon them and leave them and say, well, you didn't want to give your time, I'm not giving you my time. That's not how God works. He says, I am with you, declares the Lord. So the Lord, he doesn't stop there, stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel. He stirred up their spirits. So he didn't say, give you things you don't want to do, because my God can do that. But he says, I am with you, and I will stir up your spirits. He can give us the desire to do what he has for us to do, to run the race. We have to say, okay, here I am, Lord. Here I am. And I've been challenged by all of this, and kind of in a place in my life as well, where this is sort of what God is working on in me, is what, how is God working, right? And trusting that God has us in a place for a reason, for a purpose, and to allow God to work through us. And I know for some people, it's verses pop up a lot that are the same verses that kind of keep you focused on what God is teaching you. And for me, he often refocuses me and keeps me going on certain songs that are always playing right as I get to work, right? That remind me of my purpose that he and I talked about. And this is one of them. It's do we have it? It's Brandon Heath, No Turning Back. So let me share that with you and then we'll wrap up. Thank you, and happy Easter.